All right, with the upcoming historical trilateral summit this April 11 and 12 in the United States, China had already issued a statement and said that it opposes relevant countries cobbling together in what it described, Ambassador, as exclusionary small circles, creating bloc confrontations. Are we doing that?
Definitely not. The president has made it very clear from the very beginning that he would like to have a multilateral approach to any situation that we are facing right now in the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea, whatever you want to call it. The bottom line is that we are getting together with many of our friends and allies who believe in the same rule of law, the international waters that is obviously is important for any country, like-minded countries that are now joining us in the fact that we have the arbitration case that was decided in favor of the Philippines. That's all we're doing here, a multilateral approach. We are not doing anything that is outside of the ordinary that we feel is important for us. And again, I'd like to emphasize the president would like to see a multilateral approach into trying to solve the situation in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay. Now, the president will be visiting the United States this coming April 10, and this is his fourth U.S. visit. Within that visit is the trilateral summit. How historical is this? Is this the first of its kind?
Yes, definitely. This is the first time that an invitation like this was sent out to both Japan and the Philippines by the White House. It is something that I think is not only historical, but momentous in one sense, because we are this trilateral meeting is not only encompasses the defense of the area, the Indo-Pacific region, but also the cooperation, that the economic cooperation that we're putting together with both Japan and the United States. This is definitely going to be not only good for the Philippines, but good for the Indo-Pacific region. This will actually define the future of what our area would be like in the future.
Okay. Now, what are the expectations? When the president arrives in the U.S. on April 10, he'll first have a bilateral meeting with U.S. President Joe Biden. Is that correct?
That's correct. The meeting will take place. President Biden has invited President Marcos for a meeting with him at the White House on April 11. And shortly after that, the Prime Minister of Japan will be joining them in a trilateral summit meeting.
Okay. So the trilateral summit meeting happens after the bilateral meeting. And then Yes. Is there another trilateral meeting with cabinet officials coming from the Philippines?
Yes, actually, there will be simultaneously, almost on the same day and then perhaps the next day, we will have trilateral meetings between our Secretary of National Defense, the Department of Defense of the United States, and also the Ministry of Defense of Japan. Together with that, we will also have Secretary of State and the Secretary of Foreign Affairs will also have a meeting at the same time. And then on the economic side, we will have the Department of Trade Secretary, and the Commerce Secretary will also have a meeting separately to discuss all the aspects of our relationship with both Japan and the United States.
Yeah. So this trilateral meeting doesn't only or solely focus on the issues of the West Philippine Sea? Or is that the main focus?
No, it is really not. It's very unfortunate that China looks at this in that is directed towards them. We are really, the trilateral meeting is mainly a cooperation of three countries that believe that it is in their interest that we have this very strong cooperation. Not necessarily on defense alone, but again, the economic cooperation. And there are many aspects of the economic cooperation that we have, like the clean energy, infrastructure, digital, cyberspace. All of these things are part and parcel of what we see as important for the three countries. And in fact, there are other countries that most likely will be joining in the future.
Now, Ambassador, the president is also being criticized for actually escalating tensions with China. Number one, I want to ask you, the fact that he's visiting the United States for the fourth time, some critics have said, shouldn't the president actually meet with ASEAN leaders, our neighbors, instead of always leaning towards the United States when it comes to our maritime issues in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, again, that is absolutely not true. The fact is, President Marcos has reached out to many of our ASEAN neighbors, specifically Vietnam, Indonesia, even Malaysia, and even Brunei. He has met with all three, all the other presidents. The same, we have overlapping claims in the same area, but we are talking to them, meaning the president himself has indicated that he would like to see some cooperation with these other countries. The United States is an old ally of the Philippines, and there's no question about it. I mean, nobody can question the fact that we have been with the United States for a very long time. This is a country that feels that if they can help us, especially since it also jibes with their own national interests, then it is only natural for us to have this type of defense strategy with the United States. The United States has also offered on many occasions, not only to President Marcos, but to other presidents as well in the past, that we would like to have a stronger relationship. Remember, the Visiting Forces Agreement was signed during the time of what, 1993, 94. And then there was the EDCA, which was signed during the time of the late President Noynoy Aquino. So all of this is part and parcel of what President Marcos is just simply continuing this relationship that we have with the United States. And the fact that he's been invited to come to the United States doesn't really mean that he comes here because we are trying to lean just totally with the United States. As he has clearly said, multilateral approach to the problems in the region is his way of what he feels is the foreign policy that he has already spelled out.
Okay, now how did this trilateral summit come to be? Who actually called or asked for the summit? Because China's also reacted to Japan and said that Japan should already learn its lessons from history. So how did this trilateral summit come to be, sir?
Well, you know, in fact, I was with the president when he attended the ASEAN meeting in Indonesia, in Jakarta. And during the gala dinner, there was a side meeting between Prime Minister Kishida, President Marcos, and Vice President Kamala Harris. It was actually during that meeting that they were saying that we should try to look for ways and means to cooperate together in finding ways to be able not only to resolve some of the issues surrounding the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea, but more importantly, a stronger cooperation in the economic sphere. So I suppose that was the takeoff from that. And President Biden, of course, as you know, he's facing an election now. So he decided that perhaps inviting both President Marcos and Prime Minister Kishida to a summit in Washington, D.C. would be a perfect time to do it, especially at this juncture where we have all these challenges.
All right. Now, the Philippines or our Philippine Navy, our Philippine personnel has been experiencing what's been described as gray zone tactics. Some have described it as harassment, bullying, but not enough to actually trigger the Mutual Defense Treaty. What are our expectations from this summit that would actually change what's going on the ground in the West Philippine Sea?
You know, we have, I think our Defense Department has said it on many occasions, that they are doing what we call maximum tolerance or maximum restraint. We are doing everything we can, as the president just said in that clip that you had, that he would like to find ways and means to continue to find a way to be able to have a dialogue with China. The baseline being that we have to recognize the fact that we are protecting merely our territories. The president has said on many occasions that he really is just doing what he is supposed to do to protect the territory of the Philippines. That is his duty. It's a constitutional duty. And so with that comes talking to other friends and allies who work in the same, who are thinking the same way. They respect our territory. At the same time, they are supporting the arbitral award that was given to the Philippines. So it is all based on the freedom of navigation, international law, and the rule of law, and at the same time, the UNCLOS, which was agreed upon. And you know, China is a member of the United Nations Law of the Sea. They are a signatory to that.
Okay.
And so we're just merely trying to put together here, recognize this, and then from there we can talk about other issues.
Now, in terms of this trilateral cooperation, retired Senior Associate Justice Carpio has said that the litmus test is actually the Philippines exploring oil in the Reed Bank. Now, Malaysia's already done their own exploration without having to ask permission from China. And I think it's been a few years, and several observers have said, when will a Philippine president actually do it? Is this part of the discussions in the trilateral summit?
I don't think it will be discussed, but definitely when we're talking about energy, that will be part and parcel of that particular subject on the energy exploration. Mm-hmm. We have, as you know, we are doing it in Malampaya, and the president is very keen on really increasing our energy, our sources of energy, and exploring that, and definitely exploration of those resources in the West Philippine Sea is part and parcel of that plan. When that will be is, of course, something that we're still looking at. The Department of Energy is in discussion with potential investors and potential partners, together with those that have the concession for that particular exploration. But let me also point out, Karen, that the United States has also encouraged many of the nations in the area to get together, precisely to especially the ASEAN countries with overlapping claims, to come out with some kind of a cooperation where we will be able to explore this area for the benefit of the ASEAN region. And we can be ready to talk to even China about this.
Yeah. Actually, what's interesting... I'm sorry to interrupt you, Ambassador. Yes. Please finish.
Well, like I said, we are finding ways and means to be able to use these resources for the benefit of everyone. It's really, and also even protecting the environment. Protecting the environment means protecting everyone else. We know what climate change can do, and that these are the very same things that we have been pointing out to our friends in the region and to China. But so far we have had no response, no All positive right. response.
Now, Ambassador, during the time of former President Duterte, I remember former Foreign Affairs Secretary Alan Cayetano told me on Head Start there was a moratorium on exploration. But the bigger question now, since President Marcos Jr. has gone this far, why isn't exploration his main agenda? That would make a difference in terms of his legacy and walking the talk, right? Why isn't it the main agenda? Because the Constitution allows us to contract a third party for exploration. Why isn't it actually a part of the talks?
Well, it's not yet part of the talks, but I can tell you that precisely we are doing what we're doing right now, getting together with our friends and allies to be able to protect our area. But then together with that, obviously, is to make sure that the areas that we are going to explore, which belongs to us, will have no problem or will have no hindrance or any kind of aggressive behavior coming from other countries. And again, you know, Karen, let me just point out the kind of the wrong way of thinking for many years, since the early 90s or even before that. We have been patient. We have been accepting most of the things that have been happening in that area. You know, we had people in the Scarborough Shoal. We left, and the Chinese remained there. And our up to this day, our fishermen are not allowed to go into areas where they have been fishing for so many years. Now, what do you expect us to do? Just simply sit around and just simply say, go ahead and do this? We can't. And so President Marcos has made it very clear that he would like to look at our friends and allies to be able to band together and at the same time try to find ways and means to have a dialogue. But we need to have some kind of a muscle, if for lack of any other word, to be able to implement what we have said, that we will protect our territory.
Mm-mm. Now, Ambassador, the United States is the only treaty partner of the Philippines. What are we expecting from Japan in these talks? Of course, strengthening trilateral cooperation, that's the umbrella expectation. But when it comes to the details, what are we hoping for?
Well, Japan and the United States have come out with an agreement now that Japan will be manufacturing many of the things that defense equipment. Mm. Okay, they're also into shipbuilding. They will be. They have opened up their manufacturing of the ships, perhaps, and so we are going to be part of that arrangement where we will be able to acquire that. Some of them will probably be built in our Subic Bay area, which is. Also has a shipbuilding facility there. So this cooperation is going to help us modernize not only our armed forces, our air force, but also our Navy and our Coast Guard. Mm. All of this, again, let me emphasize, this is all part and parcel of what we are just doing to defend ourselves from any aggression that's coming from other countries.
All right. Okay.